Okay, so let's get on to surgical issues now. I find this is something that I very rarely did when I started off. And again, it will have a lot of advantages to you. So just put your hands up. Has anyone had difficulty talking to a surgeon? You know, I think that's everyone. Like if no one has had difficulty talking to a surgeon, hats off to you because, you know, you're an amazing person. So the reason I ask these surgical issue questions is not just about the answer. I don't want just information. I want to start a conversation with someone who's generally speaking on a higher hierarchy than I am. The fact that I'm a consultant now has some weight, but definitely during your training, it's going to be one of those things where you'll be the most junior person in the theater and you want to just start a very cordial conversation with them about relevant things. It breaks down a bit of the hierarchy that might exist and it shows that you're a bit assertive and you want to know about your surgeon's needs. And think about that. You're asking them for what they want. It's a very good way to start a conversation versus, hey, I need you to stop the surgery. I'm worried about the patient. That's very obstructive. And what you're doing here is being very, you know, cordial, very, very accommodating to the surgeon's needs. For yourself and for your bosses, it just shows a lot of awareness if you know how to ask these questions and get, you know, good at asking them and considering them. And again, as I mentioned, I want the first interaction that you have with someone who's potentially higher on that hierarchy scale, again, the hierarchy which I don't agree with, but they, let's say they're on that hierarchy scale, I don't want that first interaction for you to be in a crisis when you're alone in theater and something bad is happening and you've got to whisper, hey, do you mind stopping? I need to sort this out. And the surgeon looks back at you with utter contempt because you're, you know, they're in their thing, doing their work, and you're asking them to stop what they love doing. Let's take a couple examples and again, talk it through with your partners. An MVA trauma patient, 24-year-old, presents urgently to theater for laparotomy with free fluid in the abdomen and with a splenic rupture. What questions do you want to ask the surgeon? I just want to address some really great questions in the chat. And I'm sorry I didn't address those before. In the aspiration risk situation, would you ever put a nasogastric tube? I'd say the culture is that most people, especially for reflux, would never put a nasogastric tube inside you. For something like bowel obstruction, nasogastric tubes will already be put in. But there was also a court ruling that a lot of Australian anaesthetists know about and are taught about, that there was a court ruling when a patient had an aspiration event that they said if a nasogastric tube is already in, you should aspirate that with one of those large syringes prior to inducing anaesthesia. And that's something I'd routinely do. If they, for whatever reason, don't have a nasogastric tube, there's no recommendation suggests you would do that just for the surgery. If you are really passionate about it, the patient's vomiting a lot or, you know, whatever it is, I don't think it's the, you know, worst thing for you to do that. But that's where the culture of anaesthesia stands at this point in time. Aspiration during anaesthesia is very rare. And a lot of the things that we do are very good at preventing it. Aspiration often occurs not in where you expect it. In that small time frame of induction, it's often not the place aspiration occurs. It's often in things like having an LMA anesthetic where the patient does reflux slowly over a long period of risk time. It's often not in that short period of an induction, just to give you a bit of perspective. You'll see that as you go through your training. Yeah, would you consider regional block? Often people, especially surgeons, and when I was in my junior levels of training, I thought that regional block would be the answer for mortality and morbidity. So just to know that there's no morbidity or mortality evidence for regional over general anesthetic. Just think of the impact of that. That was very new to me until I saw the studies on this. The mortality benefit of, or morbidity benefit of regional over general anesthetic doesn't exist. It has pain advantages, but very rarely will you have a, you know, problem doing one or the other. And then someone says, navigating high-risk patients in the anesthetic bay, not great, right? But it's the whole sunk cost fallacy. If you need to have a conversation with someone, it doesn't matter, you know, just because you're all the way up to the operating theater, there are occasionally times when we've gone straight back into the anesthetic room when we've decided that this patient hasn't consented correctly. So it's all, no matter how late in the game it is, it's always a good time to have the right conversation. Okay, just to go back to that, sorry about that little sidetrack. And what do you want to ask the surgeon?
How long do they think the surgery is going to last for?
Great.
And how much blood loss is there going to be? There's going to be some free fluid. How much?
Yes.
And given that it is a laparotomy, I'd been considering, you know, what type of incision do they want to make? Where do they want to make it?
I think about if the laparotomy scar is very big, I'll need far more pain medications. I also think about what regional technique I could do if, depending on where that laparotomy lesion is, you know, whether I can do tap catheters or rectus sheath catheters or whatever it is. Keep going. That's really good. So position, duration, expected blood loss, where the incision is. And then the other basic things that you'll always remember because it's on the surgical safety checklist, antibiotics. as well as DVT prophylaxis. Now, when you mentioned bloodless, I thought that was really great because I often have a very detailed discussion about this because I don't know what the surgeon knows and I need them to really communicate with me. So I might ask for, you know, special requests like, does this patient need a cell saver or not? I want to give you a bit of insight about how detailed I get with this conversation and the fact that this is definitely something you can still have. I had a patient having a very difficult angio repair in a remote environment, so in the angio suite, away from theater. They had some kind of bleed in a vessel that was in their chest. And so the conversation I had to have is, how this patient is bleeding now, how likely are you to make the bleeding worse? How rapidly will that bleeding loss occur? So I'm thinking, okay, do I need to get a whole bunch of staff in there? The rapid infusion devices like the level one, do I need a massive transfusion ready and set up in this remote location and a couple of extra hands? And do I know if the surgeon can actually repair this lesion as well? So how long are you likely to have catastrophic bleeding for? And if you need to go to theater, how soon will you know? And do I need to plan for theater straight away? Just imagine how nuanced and how subtle that discussion has to be for me to know exactly what I need to do. That rarely happens, but I just want to give you a bit of insight. So position, duration, blood loss expected, antibiotics, and DVT prophylaxis. These are pretty standard questions for every operation. And then there's this special stuff, cell saver, how much blood loss, and all that detail stuff. But that's great. Let's keep going through those. 35-year-old with a deep forearm laceration for ulnar nerve and artery repair. What do you want? What questions do you want to ask the surgeon?
I would ask about the duration of the case, what position they need to be in, mm-hmm. if they need to be paralyzed, mm-hmm. Amount of blood loss expected, if they need what antis they want, DVT prophylaxis, and then if they need any other teams involved, like vascular or plastics.
Fantastic. Is there anything, and there's one extra thing, so that's absolutely right. If you were to ask those questions and you know, you inform me later, I'll be very happy because you've sorted out stuff that I had to do anyway. When they're doing nerve repair, sometimes they need to do stuff with the nerves.
This they need nerve stimulation monitoring.
Yeah. Exactly. And do I need to do anything special if there's nerve monitoring? So you might want to avoid muscle relaxation because the way they monitor the nerve is by, you know, checking where there's a muscle response when they stimulate the nerve. So that's it. I might need to avoid muscle relaxation or prove to the surgeon that I'm not giving muscle relaxation. Also, you might want to use a tourniquet as well. But again, the surgeon usually takes care of that. Total thyroidectomy, what questions do you want to ask the surgeon?
Obviously, going through the same normal five things.
Yep.
Particularly in terms of positioning, and you probably want them a bit more upright, but obviously surgeon's preference.
Yep.
Duration, blood loss, antibiotics, DVT prophylaxis, but obviously it's a bit more of a specialised surgery in terms of your intubating equipment and the surgeons taking particular care of like recurrent laryngeal nerve, that sort of thing.
Yeah, what do they do with that? That's exactly what the special request is. Have you seen much thyroid stuff? Do you know what tube I'm talking about or thinking
of? I haven't seen one, but is it something to do with that has, like, it's also got some nerve monitoring?
Exactly.
Within it?
It's called a NIM tube, NIM, or neural integrity monitor tube. So again, I want to avoid muscle relaxant and I want to use a NIM tube. And it's just a special placement that you put this floppy reinforced tube that's a bit larger down and have the black electrodes across the vocal cords, something that you'll see in their thyroid cases and you'll never think it's difficult ever again. The one thing about this is interesting because it really matters to me. The position of the arms is really important. So when I think of position, I definitely think of what you're thinking, whether they head up or prone or, you know, whatever position it is. But when the arms are in, it means that I don't have access to my cannula or my art line, if that's relevant. It's one of those other things that I always ask. So I know where to put my drips in or whether not to run TEVA if I'm worried about, witnessing the propofol going in. Okay, let's go to this case. 55-year-old for vocal cord nodule excision and biopsy. What questions do you want to ask the surgeon?
Standard questions, position, indication, antibiotics. I'm not sure if for this procedure they might use a NIM tube or something similar because of damage to the nerve.
And that's a good thought, but it is about the tube. If you were a surgeon, what do you, there's something that you want that I don't want you to have because it gets in my way.
I guess the tube itself will be
absolutely going. That's exactly right. When surgeons are all about exposure and access, and we're all about control, and those two don't always match. And so the special requests I have for this, so again, exactly what you said, all the usual stuff, position, duration, antibiotics, DVT, prophylaxis, and then what kind of airway would you prefer? And I encourage you again, as a bit of a tip, when you're in your ENT theater, ask for them to use something a bit different. There's all these different airways that you'll use in ENT cases, like such as jet ventilation through supraglottic devices, transtracheal devices like a Hunsicker or Benjet tubes. And these are things that I've often during my training just asked if I could use them just to be able to see how to use them because they're not very commonly used. The final thing as well in ENT surgeries often, it's like say for FES surgery, functional endoscopic sinus surgery, is to have a throat pack or something like that. So again, things you wanna know about and to ask. Let's go with this case. Cesarean section with placenta praevia and potential accreta. What questions do you want to ask the surgeon and any special requests for this? And for those that don't know, placenta praevia with accreta is just a ridiculously high bleed risk. And it's, you know, just the worst bleed risk you can imagine next to having a ruptured AAA. So just a hint, but there's a lot of things that I can do to help mitigate that problem.
I guess the usual five things that we've already discussed, the position may be more important here, the duration of surgery, anti-DVT prophylaxis, and obviously in this one, especially the expected blood loss of the surgery.
Absolutely.
I'd like to know if we've got recent coags and the access to TEG monitoring throughout the case.
Absolutely. Because of the blood loss, is there anything you could do to help with that blood loss? So I definitely want all that monitoring, rotem or TEG, and again, like getting all the right blood results to understand whether this patient has a group and hold valid cross match with no antibodies, so I don't delay it because I'm worried about a massive transfusion. In this particular case, Cell Saver can be used in pregnancy, but also the fact that I might need two surgeons, and one of those surgeons, often we'd get, say, a gynae-onc surgeon because they're very good at hysterectomies, because that might be where this needs to go very, very quickly. And I might even have two anaesthetists as well. 88-year-old, severe pulmonary hypertension for nail bed repair on finger. Again, what questions do you want to ask the surgeon?
So, yeah, the usual things that we've discussed. Position, duration, expected blood loss, antibiotics, and DVT prophylaxis. But I guess more significantly, we probably won't need GA for this particular case if they're happy with regional.
That's perfect. That's exactly what I want you to ask. Plus, plastics is one of those lists where you'll get lots and lots of patients who are quite elderly with lots and lots of comorbidities. And the surgeons are so good in just, like you said, having everything done under local anesthetic with very minimal, if no sedation. So special request, can we avoid general anesthetic? And that makes everyone's day a lot less stressful. So that's great. And again, this is just a very specific part of the anesthetic plan in the sense that I'm asking the surgeons about what they need and what they can, you know, accept. And I'm not doing my full anesthetic plan just to keep that separate. Someone's asked a really good question about for high risk placenta praevia, would you consider going with general anesthesia from the get-go? And absolutely. So most of these high risk bleed cases in pregnancy, we would do that straight away. And that will be part of the anesthetic plan. But something, again, you could ask the surgeon, look, you know, I'd almost offer that I'll be doing a general anesthetic. Hope that's all right with you. So surgical is, in summary, position, duration, blood loss, antibiotics, DVT prophylaxis, and then a whole bunch of special requests that, again, I want you to be aware of now to show that you have insight. And this is actually really easy stuff to learn. You know, once you know it, you know it. It's not difficult at all. And stuff that through my years of training, junior registrars aren't thinking of straight away. And hopefully this will keep you looking pretty good. Any questions before we move on?
I think there was a question in the...
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's a good question. I'll answer that. So if you have bleeding risk, it's either going to be due to these four things, tissue, tone, thrombin, or trauma. And so that's the broader aspect of how I'd address this. So tissue, that's exactly why this bleed is happening, because there's tissue retained. And that's, you know, my primary problem. Trauma, often not in this situation, but I'd address that as well. And then thrombin, after a lot of blood loss or pre-existing problems, I'd need to address that, and I'd, you know, constantly replace factors, use rotem or TEG to constantly do that and reassess. But in the specific part of tone, that's exactly right. So I would, volatile is causes uterine laxity, so I'd use propofol or run low volatile and nitrous, and then I'd address all the other things such as giving syntocin, ergometrin, prostaglandin, like such as carboprost as well. Yeah, it's a good question. We never seem to have a Cell Saver. So often hospitals that aren't big trauma hospitals have to call in a Cell Saver, and you have to call them in, you have to book them in, or call them in with a lot of prep time. So the last ruptured vessel that I had to deal with just this week, we couldn't get Cell Saver booked in. So, you know, if you're planning for something, you definitely have to plan for it early in smaller hospitals.